So I kind of changed the title because there was a little confusion. I said clusterization, and people thought clusterization basically means how to set up a cluster. This is actually more intricate. This is the story about how I ended up clusterizing a policy which was written for a standalone bro. And it was basically the case in study was scan detection. So, but I think you will find this talk still interesting. I'm from Berkeley Lab. This is an obligatory slide we just show. We have 13 guaranteed parking spots, and that is what you get if you win Nobel Prize there. And it's birthplace of Bro as well, so that's our bragging right. And I think birthplace of TCP dump, and BPF, and I think ring buffer. Anyways. Yeah. Scan detection is also written here, clusterized one. But there's a bunch of other enclaves and so on and so forth. Some facilities are really good if you are visiting lab. You should see those. So this is an overview. I think the first 6-7 slides are actually boring in sense that I'm trying to make a case for scan detection. How many here actually think scan detection is useful? OK, good. I have some support. And how many think are actually blocking on scan detection? So this is where is the motivation. I want rest of the crowd here to be able to feel confident that, you know, we can block scanners. It's OK to do so. And then I want to talk about internals of scan detection, like what exactly is going on inside, how I ended up clusterizing it, and what were the problems, how is the performance, and what's out for future. So this is an interesting quote. Like, I think everybody should read it and think about it. I spent 3 days thinking about it, actually. So the Partha is a coworker in the team. He has been at the lab for a very long time. And he said it perfectly well. Like, this is an attribution problem. What is a scan? Like, is there a good scan, bad scan? Like, depending, like, if you have an external pen tester who is scanning, it's not a bad activity at all. So it's always an intentionality problem. But what I am doing, or we end up doing, is measurement. Like, OK, if n happens, then do this. If n plus 1 happens, then do this more, so on and so forth. But this was underlying motivation overall. But the big problem I have is with reconnaissance. And the complaint here is, like, we want to know if the scans are coordinated, who are these players. We generally cannot even figure that out. What actually is the scale of recon? So Vern and Mobin actually did great work about figuring out distributed SSH brute force scanning. But that is specific to SSH brute force scanning. I would actually want it to be done for all kinds of scanners, every port, every process, every possible thing. And then there is no clear success criteria. Like, you know, somebody comes, scans you. Was it a successful scan or was it not successful? We don't even know that. Maybe it's a bad guy who is looking for that one SSH server in your network. He found it, and it's done, and it's probably a successful thing for them. Maybe somebody's scanning your entire 2 class Bs, and they could never figure it out. So this is all very, like, fuzzy and difficult. And we see all the traffic, but we don't know what attackers found. Like, what is the output of nmap on their screen? I wish I could actually see that on my screen, too. So this was a case, like a research paper I worked on long back, like 6-7 years back now. And these were basically the categories of, like, what are the different phases in which attacks happen, when are the alerts getting generated, and how many of them we are catching. And turns out in scan phase, there was only one. And the way we caught it is, like, OK, this guy is scanning. It was a brute force SSH scan. Turns out the machine got compromised, but the alert got generated. Most of the time, this is where you find things, when they start misusing your computers. So the idea is, like, can we attribute every incident which happened at the lab or at your organization to original reconnaissance or scan? Like, OK, yeah, I have a FTP server compromise. Oh, I can relate to this. This was actually 18 days back. They did an FTP scan. It's very difficult. We cannot actually figure out. And I think that's why it is important. We need to know what is the malicious activity, what is the intention, and can we do it quickly? So, like, paying attention to reconnaissance is a good defense mechanism. If you can block them early, they cannot actually compromise any further. So, and then I went and said, okay, let me characterize network traffic. I had a really interesting graph, and Partha said it's useless, so I didn't put it here. But this is actually, and this is one of the qualities of Bro. It actually gives you all these different details. And this is basically copied from the wiki page, just for my reference. But like S0 is connection attempt seen and no reply. So of about 220 million connections we saw, 45 million were basically there was a connection attempt, but there was no reply. And this is like as obvious as it can get. 65% of your traffic is kind of nonsense traffic. It's scan activity. So scan detection should not be difficult. Like if it's 65% of your traffic, you should be able to flag it. And then there is rest of all this traffic. Some of them is fuzzy. Like for example, where is this thing? This is almost always legitimate traffic, OTH. But then rejects are like, you can start figuring things out. But yeah, I think it would be nice if all of you actually basically generate this graph too. So now traditionally, scan detection is actually one of these few strategies. Either you have summary, like N IPs are actually connected to by a remote IP and T amount of time. Then there is a signature base, like, okay, there is a Metasploit scan, or there is a behavior base where NMAP, like NMAP would by default actually scan port 80, 443, and ICMP. If we characterize it, we can say, yeah, this might be an NMAP. And then there's probabilistic method like threshold random walk. I am not sure many of you have heard about this, TRW, no? So this was again one of the policies which Vern wrote way back, and it actually is a very, very powerful detection mechanism. It can actually flag a scanner within 4 connections. And it's pretty good, actually. The only thing is it uses math and probabilities, and I need to figure out how to convert that to a clusterized setup. But then I actually was thinking, reading the threshold random walk paper only, I was like, okay, I should actually create one more thing, which is called know your network approach. And then I came up with 2 things, knock, knock, and landmine was already existing. So, and I'll go into the more details on each one of them. And this is an overly simplified, like I think if you want to talk about old scan detection, Seth is the right person to talk to. He hates that policy, it's kind of complicated. This is a very simplified version of it. But what it did was like if UDP scan detection is enabled or not, then there is a whole lot of skipping, like whitelist this, whitelist this, whitelist this, ignore this. If connection is established, then you actually go into the port scan detection, or otherwise you run one of these 4 heuristics. And this was actually standalone. So I want to clarify one more thing. I have been using Bro for a long time, and it's hard for me to move to the next version. So this policy was actually last there in Bro 153, which is few years back actually now. And what I did was I actually ported the policy to Bro 2, and then 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, 2.4, and actually it works with 2.52. But it's not clusterized. So the big motivation was we need to clusterize it. And I have my own separate stream for scan detection. Bro came up with another scan detection using some stats framework, and that is what is Stock Bro. So the story is like, okay, old scan would do is like all these different detections were in one particular heuristic file. So, but I thought we need to break this up. We need to have a dedicated TCP scan detection, dedicated UDP. In fact, even we should do is a different detection for external versus internal scanner. So that was the angle I said, okay, I need to work on each one of them independently. So, and this is the motivation. And this is such a great leverage I had. Like we know what they don't know. Bro tells me everything I have on my network. Now, scanners want to find stuff. I already know about it, so I also know what's not there. So when they are knocking each and every door, I know this door is, somebody's here, somebody's not there. So we know, but, and then the big negative is we don't know what they actually found out until you actually have a compromise, or you have a report coming from Washington, D.C. that this port is open or this is a vulnerable machine. And then, but this is what I would really want to achieve. We want to know what's, they actually know or they want to know, like why would they come to my network and what are they looking for? What is the intention? Turns out it's a bad PHP vulnerability. I'm gonna dedicate my resources to fix that before anything else. So it kind of gives you a prioritization too. So these were 4 heuristics. Now knock knock is a term I just came up with, but imagine this heuristic. I think the most simplest way to understand this is, you know how to enter your house. Where is the main door? What is the entrance? Now imagine a guy from Tanzania who is blind, wants to enter your house. What are they going to do? They are going to stumble on the fence, then they are going to stumble on the wall, they are going to stumble on the window, and then finally figure out the door. That is what knock-knock is. So what Bro does is it actually keeps a track of all the known valid services across all the systems in the lab. And then when attacker is actually trying to connect to a system which actually does not have an open service, it says, this is red flag. I'm going to count how many more such things happen. So I started competing knock-knock with threshold random walk. Threshold random walk was doing 4 connections. I said, can I risk at 3? And it actually was fairly useful at 3. But then I ended up blocking a bunch of things I was not supposed to. So I came up with this different, I was stubborn as well. I said, okay, I need to do something. So I still kept low value at 3, but then I had a medium threshold and then I had a high threshold. So knock-knock works at like 12, 15, then 5 or 7, and then 3. And then this is landmine. This is such an obvious thing. We have 2 class Bs. That is about 130,000 IP addresses. We have 15,000 systems. So rest is all empty. If it is empty, somebody goes to an IP address which is not allocated, why would they do it? This is no-brainer. So this was actually good. This is the stock bro scan detection from back in when scan.bro actually came to existence, where bro actually treats each connection differently depending on the application protocol. Then it performs bookkeeping, then it actually figures out if how many connections were failing, how many are successful, and based on that it would actually give us. But then the deal here is to eliminate false positives. You have to have at least 20, 40, 100 connections before you can say this is a scan. And I said, and we have been using this. This has been working very, very effectively. And then backscatter detection is fun and useful, but it's not quite scan. It's basically somebody is victim of a DOS attack, and we are just getting thank you notes from them. So the problem is like this guy is victim already, and we think this is scanner, so we block them too, which is not right. So I said, okay, we need to identify backscatters so that we don't block these guys. Like Facebook should not be blocked because they get DOSed. So, but here was the big problem. When you want to clusterize scan detection, it's exactly opposite of clusterization. Like clusterization is take this network traffic stream, divide it into n parts, and then basically you have lot of leeway because the traffic is 1/n on each worker. Now, scan detection is exactly opposite. You have to take all the connections and aggregate them together. So there is so much overhead and load. And so for example, your block threshold is 20. Now you have 10 workers running. Assuming everything is uniform, each worker is going to see 2 connections. So by the time each worker sees 20, you had 200 connections already done. It's not right. Now, so what you need to do is every worker has to be talking to each other, like, how many did you see? Well, 1, 2. So, and as soon as 2, then you, in theory, you are supposed to block. So this was a difficult thing. And then Bro has, or used to have a function, like a directive called %sync. Which actually doesn't exist or doesn't work quite well. So it's like what it would do is it would actually share and synchronize the state across the board. So we need to do that. Each worker should be able to know what is the state of other workers so that we can make decisions properly. And it has to be done in speed because, you know, if it's a fast scanner and you said, okay, I'm going to decide after 5 minutes, then it's no use. So this was kind of tricky and difficult preposition. I just add, this is basically copy and paste from the wiki as well. But these are like, so I said, okay, I'm going to do scan detection. How are you going to do scan detection? Well, what is a scan? Somebody says sends a SYN, you get a reset back. Okay, I'm TCP dump, yeah, I see this. Well, what happens in Bro? Well, Bro gives you an event. It gives you an event of connection attempt. So everything is ready-made. It was cooked for me. I did not have to worry about it. TCP flags level, because all these events were sufficient enough to give me what I needed. And so that actually kind of helped significantly. Now, the interesting part start. I was very lazy. So I actually worked on this entire architecture. It was completely wrong. I talked with Seth, and it's like, this is wrong. And I was lazy because if this is wrong, why should I digitize it? So I just like scanned and put it. So I talking with Seth is always revealing. It's like you learn a lot more about yourself too. So I came up with a different architecture, and this one was actually again, like, okay, if this doesn't happen, do this. This is where the cluster and the manager and workers. This was such bad architecture that it's like not even. I'm going to delete this line. So this was wrong. This was unoptimal, not performing well, too much overheads. But we learned something, and this was a good architecture. Finally came up with this thing. And a lot of feedback and input from Seth, and it actually took very little time to come up. So I feel good about it. I don't know you guys, but the groundbreaking feature, literally in scan detection, was that you should actually divide it into two parts, something done by workers and then something done by manager. So what is done by workers is validation. Is this connection even worthy of scan or not? So I have all kinds of different validation. That's the next line. But if I actually put that on worker, so if this is not knock knock validation passes, then I pass a K. And if it's a cluster, it actually goes here. Otherwise, that is an uninteresting connection. I'm not going to even send it to the manager. And the idea here was that of 220 million or a billion connections you see every day, how many do you want to send to manager? How to minimize that workload? So, but yeah, do validation here and then run scan detection. If you find scan, then basically you have a feedback mechanism. Here is all the list of events which actually feed to this system. And then if it's a scan, then we actually started deploying netcontrol framework, which is phenomenally good. And it actually saves us a lot of pain. And you'll see what improvements it actually brought. And then netcontrol actually manages all the blocking and unblocking for us. So like you determine and scan, and then you give it to netcontrol. That's all we have to do. So these were my validation criteria. So in case of knock-knock, let's go for only TCP connections. If it's internal, don't ignore it. Then if it's fast darknet, let's just fast track this thing. And I'll explain what that is, and so on and so forth. And then this is definition of a failed connection, like is failed and reverse failed. So this actually is that definition. So if these criteria meet, then only validation happens. Otherwise, that connection is not considered at all. So, and this is actually all stolen from 153 code or the current scan.bro. This is like, I did not write anything. I copied, pasted most of this stuff. So, but yeah, this is a cheat sheet, like how to clusterize. I was actually looking at Johanna's code one day, and then it's like, huh, this is how you clusterize. So what do I do after I learned that? Let's clusterize scan detection. So this is like, I think if you all want to write policies, this is one to look at. Very simple. You have to, and actually I use this trick, like I said, okay, put worker to manager and manager to worker so that your brain actually has one less thing to worry about. And then here is how you declare the events. And this is just new connection event, but this is the stuff in purple here is the code which would run on manager because of this directive. And this is the code which would run on the workers. And this is the way you control the code execution. And what happens here is that all the workers actually see a new IP address, it adds to a cache. If it's already in cache, then like it looks for membership check and then adds to the cache. Workers would actually call this event, which actually calls manager, and then manager actually populates. So the idea is like each worker sees an IP, and then it actually sends it to the manager that I saw that IP. This is all it does, but this gives you a good clusterization model. So this is how scan detection in cluster now looks like. So each worker would actually do validation here. And if it passes, it actually sends it to the manager. Manager takes care of all counting and all the different heuristics. So now if you have 20, 30, 40 workers, this is all you have to do. So now one of the big bar is like you should have same capability as what was in the old scan detection. So I actually did a kind of a comparison where it's like, okay, this is landmine. I actually extended the feature, the old scan detection where you had to specify that these are the subnets for landmine. Right now, what we do is our networking group publishes the list of allocated subnets. So Bro uses input framework, sucks up that list, and then it knows from our local nets what are unallocated subnets because it's a membership test. If it's not an allocated subnet, then it's an unallocated. So this is real time. Like networking goes, decides to put another slash 24 in allocated subnets. It's going to go propagate up to bro. You don't have to worry about it. It's real time. Everything should actually take care of itself, and you won't be blocking on any allocated subnets anymore. Address scan is pretty much consistent. It's same thing, like take this code, modularize it, put it in the new setup. Shutdown threshold is still same. In backscatter, I actually extended it. Previous backscatter was only dealing with these particular ports. Now I have a very lame logic where I saw certain patterns of backscatter traffic where the, like, you know, if somebody is DOSing on port on IRC 6667, you get replies back, but the source port is always 6667, and the reply is actually either SYNAC or a reset. So the scan detection understands that and then calls it a backscatter. Then knock knock is new, and then which one is this? Oh, and yeah, the clusterization is new. False positive is an improvement. I feel good about it. So the old scan detection, the problem was bro would have content gap. It would drop packets. Bro would think that bro would get confused with directionality of the connection because it actually, so there is a SYN, there is a SYNAC, but SYNAC got dropped. So bro is like, huh, there's this something wrong, and then there is, what's going on? And it would actually flag those things, and that would become problematic. The new setup actually takes care of these kinds of behavior. And so this is where the talk actually should get interesting now. So I said, okay, we have scan detection, we have clusterization. How long did that take? It actually took 3 or 4 days to do this stuff. But rest of the time was actually here. So we looked at memory management, speed of detection, accuracy, so on and so forth. So here is actually one of the performance measurement I did. This is so unscientific, but it was helpful to me. What I did was I actually literally created these counters. I said, okay, in each function, I'm going to put a counter at the very top, and then increment the counter if the flow control goes into the counter function. And so in new connection, let's put it, catch and release, put it, check scan, just put these counters. And I collected, so I had a lot of data, but I ended up using these two data sets. One is for 1 day, and it's actually for 18 hours or something. And this is for 7 days. So this is about 185 million connections. This one is 1.5 billion connections. And don't pay attention to the percentage, that might be actually wrong. But the idea is I have absolute numbers too. So how many times is catch and release active? It's actually 150% of the time it runs. So like if your code sees 100 new connections, this function is actually called 150 times. And that is bad and inefficient. And the story is like, I asked Johanna, can I figure out if netcontrol is handling it? She said, oh, yeah, there is this function. I was so happy. I went and wrote it. And I just added it. And by default, if you add something, it's highly inefficient. I still haven't changed it. But then if it's not scanner, how many times the code flow goes here, how many times it goes to, like, so this is the filtration. So 31% of time or 24% if you actually are using the data for a long amount of time, it actually goes into the filter or the validation part. And then this is where it says how many times the validation is successful. And that basically translates into how many times run scan detection happens. So roughly 13% of the connections actually are calling the event run scan detection. So I think if I have 200 million connections a day, the whole idea was that workers can take some responsibility and we send less traffic to manager, and that's what started happening here. So, and then each of one of these functions. So how does it actually look overall? So if we say we had 100 connections here, this particular check is running 150 times, but then each one of these validations actually run very little. This one runs very much less because we already know what are landmine or allocated addresses and what are unallocated addresses. And then this code runs about 15% of time, but overall run scan detection runs about 13% of the time. So that is the performance gain. Now I also have like 43% of the time, this is a scanner. So this actually shunting goes up here. So we already know this is a scanner, let's not even process it anymore. This is a scanner, let's not process it anymore. And that's what actually results in lowering numbers at these places. And then this is actually less than 0.5%, actually even very minuscule. But this was another one was actually, I figured out that bro has a hyperlog log. That is a data structure where you can actually do cardinality count measurement. You can put like billions of elements in a very, very small data structure. So, but I did not trust bro. I did not trust this new feature. So what I did was I actually ran parallel code, I said, OK, I'm going to run sets, and I'm going to run cardinality. And let's count how many elements over time are on both data structures, because I wanted to just have one-to-one mapping. And it's actually literally same numbers. And this is about, I think, 10 or 20 hours of data. And I had about 1.2 million elements by end of it. And it's the same. But here is the good slide. This is where the memory usage was. So if you go with set, this is where it was about 1.2 GB. And this was hyper-log-log cardinality. So this seems like a roughly 80% improvement in the memory. And in scan detection, you have to keep track of all the connections happening. So 200 million a day, like if your bro does not restart for 15 days, that's about 3 billion connections. So this thing adds up very much quickly. So, and this one basically is, this is the code how to do this. And this number here, 0.1 and 0.99, the way I actually came up with that was I had higher numbers, like 0.9 and I don't remember 0.2 or 0.5. And then I would count connection logs and see if cardinality output here is what actually is in count log. And basically, this number here gets me near accurate. Approximation is very close to the real numbers. So like, for example, I had 357 connections. If I go with like 0.1 and 9, 0.9, it would show me 290. But if I go with 0.99, it would actually show me 352 or 358. So, but then there was another problem. I wanted scan detection to be fast, like very fast. So when everything was running, this is actually the mean time between connections. So if you actually divide every connection, this is what time comes up. But this is what was the detection latency. So this particular table should show this is the timestamp, this is the IP address, what was the heuristic which detected it, what was the initial time when the very first connection was seen, what was the time when the detection happened. So if you subtract this from this, you should get this. And then this was like, this is not making sense. This is not right. So, but do you guys see a pattern here? Everything is 5 point. So I was like, what is happening? And then I did what what a bro person should do, I called Seth. So here is the problem. There are timers. And when these timers expire, then only bro would actually give me the data. So by default, my instinct was, OK, change all of them. Bad idea, right? So I did not do that. I did not change. But I leveraged on one thing, and it was very obvious. I knew my network. So I said, OK, I'm going to fast track all the landmine connections. If you are connecting to an unallocated IP address, I'm going to just ship that thing from the new connection event. I'm not going to worry about connection state remove or connection attempt or any of the other connections. So that's the way I actually started fast tracking those connections. And that actually worked a whole lot better than I expected. And this is finally the result was. Like, OK, so the numbers actually got reduced substantially well. And this is the mean time, average time between the connections, and so on and so forth. And so this actually speeded up the detection significantly fast. So now I have a new feature called whitelist management. So we generally do whitelisting in ACL, but I said, OK, bro should do whitelist management. And this was a very good feature to have. It's cluster. So everything I had to do was clusterized. Like whitelist has to be clusterized. So you go, you enter a subnet, you enter an IP address. It gets read into bro using input framework. And then manager sends the whitelist to all the workers. And if you remove it, remove an IP or a subnet from whitelist, then manager broadcasts that to the workers too. And if you remove, then bro actually would go and remove the block from ACL as well. So you don't have to worry about it. And the fun part is, let's say if you actually add a subnet, let's say we added Facebook and Facebook /20 or /21. And there are more than 520 scanners from IP addresses from Facebook, which actually got blocked. So as soon as you add that subnet, all the scanners in that subnet would actually get removed. So previously, we used to have problem like, OK, you remove one, and then all of a sudden, another person is complaining, and oh, yeah, there is one more. And then there is one more. So now bro understands, and it actually takes care of all that. So, and because this is all input framework, it works without starting. So this is how whitelisting actually looks like. So here is the scan, this IP scan 12 host. Block got actually removed, but this was a web crawler. Basically, it got added to purge on whitelist, and then basically it actually got removed from the system. So then I have one more very interesting feature, and this is called hot subnets. So what I actually did here was let's find if there are scanners originating from same subnet. If they are, let's block that subnet rather than blocking all the IP addresses from that subnet. And how would you do that? So I said, let's go with the simple model. Let's see. Let's just do it for slash 24. I wish I could know actually like how each ASN is allocated. That would be easier, but right now, no. So the way it works is like here is this .20, .42, 171. So when there were three scanners, we would get a notice that three scanners are originating from this slash 24. When it gets to 10, we get another notice. So I think the numbers are 3, 10, 25, 50, 100, so on and so forth. So here is the numbers. We had 55,000 slash 24 from which there were at least three scanners, and we have 8 from where at least there were 200. So this is quest time. Do you want to guess what those 8 are from? What country? Anyone? Okay, let's just see this. So first 4 are from Brazil, actually. And funny part is 216, 17, 18, and 19. So, but then look at this one here. These guys actually say this is for internet security research. I always get scared when people do internet security research on their own. But yeah, this was but there is a whole lot. Then there is all this stuff. But yeah, like Bro would actually tell you that this is the subnet which has been most nuisance for you. And it actually just pretty much pops up over the time. So now then I had to do false positive detection. This one was basically, for lack of better word, I called it SF. So SF means that the connection was established in Bro. It was a legitimate connection, everything was good. So I started blocking stuff where people would complain, and I said, historically we had a connection established to this particular source destination IP, which is an external IP address. Now Bro says that this is a scanner. So I actually added everything, like all the connections which were originating from the lab to outside, I would actually add that to a Bloom filter, and that worked very well because Bloom filter is cheap, easy to run. So if ever a connection originating from me inside the lab goes to an IP and that IP gets flagged at the scanner, it actually comes and checks against this Bloom filter, and then it says, no, this is a scanner, we are not gonna block. This is not a scanner, we had a connection originating, we are not gonna block it. So this kind of gives me a validation as well as like saves me from blocking stuff where Nagio's check is coming in and systems got rebooted and then the connection started failing and so on and so on. And this was very straightforward implementation. You guys can like look at it or figure out or send me an email about this one. And then I had one more thing, which was dynamic threshold. Let's mess with the attackers. Let's mess with the scanners. Like somebody just says, I want to do recon on lab. And they figured out like, they block at 20, I'm gonna run only 19 connections. So I said, I'm gonna have dynamic thresholds. So the way dynamic thresholds work is that I came up with this thing called popularity of the port. How many remote scanners are actually scanning this particular port? Based on that, I say this port is in high demand. If it is in high demand, then the threshold goes low. If it is in low demand, threshold goes high. And this actually kind of prevents me from blocking stuff, which is very weird, like somebody's using Xbox to connect to somewhere else, and then connections are very weird and wacky, and it's on port 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then you don't block it because it's only one IP address. So this actually works pretty well. Bro would block depending on what are the conditions at very low thresholds or very high thresholds. So, and then this was illegitimate. We want to be on the top hit of Google. So you don't want to block web crawlers. Port scan is like when a crawler would go from one IP to another, it's a scan. So what do you do? I said, let's identify web crawlers. Bro would let me do that. So in HTTP request and HTTP header, I know that this is a web crawler. It's okay, web bots, or it's actually, where is it? Search engine robots are coming in. So I actually find those, and if they are there, I would add them to whitelist, and we would not block. And if we had blocked it, we would go and unblock those. So this was an interesting feature, additional. And this was one where I actually said I dug myself into a big hole. This is basically a summary of an entire scan lifetime. So when was this, this is the IP, when was this IP detect, like what was the heuristic, when did the scan start, when did it actually end, according to Bro, when was it detected? So it actually goes incrementally, like every hour you would see statistics, and you can see this scan, and what was the total lifetime. So imagine this data for 1 year. You should be able to know what is generally characteristic behavior of each scanner, especially from what subnets, who is scanning how. So, but this was a mess. This was very difficult to do because you, and again, Seth came to help. So this one was where you have to like figure out each connection and then so on and so forth. And I don't think this is still optimal, but it works without crashing Bro or creating a lot of problems. This is the block speed. So the way we block is Bro actually talks to broker, broker talks to ACLD, ACLD goes to Quagga and goes to router. So previously we would actually take about 200 to 300 milliseconds to block. Right now with net control, the number is roughly around 800 microseconds. So this is difficult right now because this time, the detection time is actually network time. And this is actually the wall clock time on the system. So both of them have inconsistencies. The next slide actually shows you this thing. So at t equals to zero, we detected, then net control requested the block. So this thing is basically so high. The reason is because this is actually the wall clock time, and this is the network time. So Bro was probably running overloaded and slow. That's why this is a fake number. This is not the right number. But this is where broker actually, the net control sent message to ACLD. This is where ACLD got the message. Now, why is it negative? Because this is from a different computer. This is from a system which is running ACLD. And even though NTP is working, I think things get funny when you are talking in microseconds and so on and so forth. But overall, ACLD took 61 microseconds to complete. And then, so this all adds up. So we actually went from 300 milliseconds to roughly around, at least I can say comfortably 20, 30 milliseconds for dropping a connection. And I think in microseconds. This is actually a graph. This is what bad guys want to know. This is graph of, I said, okay, can we chart what we know? So this is actually a port, and these are all the computers which actually have this port open at the lab. So this is, I created this table called known services. Because I know this table, anything outside this is a scan. And that is how I was actually plotting. So this is, I think, 80. This is 443, 22 somewhere, so on and so forth. And this is pretty usable installation. Like, all the files are basically here. The best part is actually scan config. All the parameters actually are in this particular one single file. You go, you just mess with one file, set up values there, and you don't have to worry about rest of the scan heuristics. But yeah, here is the cheat sheet of how to understand it properly. There were reliability issues, like what if, so I am determining landmine based on subnet ingestion, which is networking group is providing me. What if that file is inaccurate or something breaks and the file is empty? That means I am going to block everything because everything is unallocated now. That is wrong. So there are all these checks and balances, like if the file is empty, don't block anymore on this heuristic. If it's incomplete, like, it had 433 elements before. Now it has 27. There is a problem. Block, don't kick in this heuristic. So there are some checks and balances like that. So then this was actually pass and fail criteria from my boss, which was like, let's not miss anything from the past and then find more badness. Should it be fast? Should it be, we should have a practical false positive rate. Like, you don't want a Nobel Prize winner to call, why am I blocked? So, or like, why is my Facebook blocked? People get mad at that thing. So, and then it should pass peer review. It hasn't passed peer review yet. And then Bro should run stable for 1 month. If it crashes, it's not good. So, but most of this are actually good criterias. We actually, I have not reached this part where we should know what they know. So this is not reachable. This works, but I think this is the difficult one currently. This is where is my list for users, developers, and Bro people. And I think this column is only going to be understood by a few people here. But it's like for users, all you need to worry about is a notice.log and scan summary. That should give you a very good picture of what is going on in your network. And then developers will have a table called known scanners. I always wanted this table so that I can use it in other heuristics. Like, this is a scanner. Let's not waste energy anymore. So, and then pro people need to make this persistent. I think that is Matthias. So, and then memory efficient, you already saw the graphs. And then whitelisting capability is pretty good. Speed and accuracy is pretty good. But here is the big question. I haven't started pushing for it, but I wonder if scan detection should be actually not in policy land, but should go back into like, should be in C++ land inside Bro. So these were some things which actually came to my mind. This is the list which is actually my wish list of what a scan detection should be, and it's long. So this thing here, it goes to the next page and goes to this next page. So nobody reads it except what when I wrote it, and then I continuously read it. If you guys read it and have ideas, let me know. Like it has good things actually, like, okay, identify if it's a .gov, if it's US or a foreign EDU, let's have more respect for them. If it's from Brazil, block them quickly, so on so forth. So, but here is the code, like the code is available on GitHub. I was able to make a package. It was seamless. So that was good. So you can actually do that too. But here is the deal. I realized this entire project was fun and good, and I learned a lot, but I learned more about me than Bro. And the idea is like, I am not a good coder. Justin is much better, so I'm actually talking him into doing all this stuff. So he already has a, and that's where like smartness comes. So he has a unified scan detection policy, which is much simpler, more optimized, and much better. Justin has all those optimizations which he talked about in his talk. I don't have any of those. So if you want to play, this is one where you should try actually out and give us feedback, because I think next version should have this thing coming in. But if you have any questions or any comments, here is the contact information. And any questions here, you can, yeah. Yes, yes. Yeah, you know, your question makes me think I should have one more slide about netcontrol and Bro. So what the Bro does, it actually hands over to netcontrol. Netcontrol then knows what to do, and it knows how to go and talk to ACLD or other devices which are going to be blocking. And once netcontrol does it, it is managing everything for me. So the only thing netcontrol does, it actually gives me some events back if I am interested. And one of the event is netcontrol says I am not going to manage it anymore. So once netcontrol actually sends this back to me, then I know netcontrol is not managing it. So I'm going to reactivate that as a scan, potential scanner. And then scan detection again detects it, sends it back to netcontrol. But netcontrol runs is what is a very, very beautiful setup, which is called catch and release. So you block them, then they come back again, you block them immediately at the next connection. So netcontrol would actually manage it for 1 day, 3 days, 30 days, so on and so forth. So netcontrol generally sends me a message back after 30 days that this is a bad IP, I'm not managing any. Any other questions? So yeah, that's where like one of the slides said, let's just break them apart. Like previously it used to be the same heuristic. Now I want, so I have another heuristic for internal scan detection. So externals is like you can be much more ruthless and harsh. Internal turns out a sysadmin figured out a new way to connect to 20 systems. So let's actually have a more like context to why that could be a scanner. And right now, like for all practical purposes, we have a very, very strong setup with NetFlows to do that as well. I don't know the answer to it, actually, because the difficult thing to measure, I think the biggest thing is overheads of communication, where I, like if you're sending a million events from worker to manager, like would that be easier or cheaper on same box or like multiple boxes, or is going to be exactly opposite? I don't know that yet. Oh, no, I don't think Bro actually knows that, like Bro or cares about it, if it's same box or if different box. Because like what Bro is giving me, and I think Robin can answer this accurately, is that there is a worker to manager event. So all I do is actually call that event and pass whatever arguments I want to. And that argument could be a table, actually, in fact, I realize. So you can actually put IP or you can put a very complex table of records and structures. But I think the only thing with clusterization is that you have to be careful about how much communication is happening, because it can get very tricky very quickly. But it's very elegant once you like figure things out, yes. Any other questions? All right, thank you so much.